Hi, welcome to my channel, the Machine Learning Engineer. Today I'm continuing with the ML and MLOps in Database. We will do a second video, a second use case of LLM Ops in Database. In this case, instead to use a model that we physically can download to our workspace, we will use a model that is service as model as a service, like is the case of OpenAI GPT-4. We are going to create a code reviewer with the OpenAI. We will be accessing to GPT-4 using the OpenAI interface, and this what you are going to see here is something that you can replicate with any model that is service like OpenAI. Is essentially everything that is integrated with MLflow. Let me take a look. So what you see here, what you are gonna see here in this tutorial is applicable to any model that is served as again as a model or machine inference as a service, which is what is doing OpenAI, Mosaic, Anthropic, Cohere, AWS, Hugging Face, Azure Machine Learning, and Palm 2 and AI 21 Labs. So today we will do again a code reviewer with the OpenAI GPT-4. We will lock this model into the model registry in Databricks, and then on we will create a class to grab the OpenAI model. We are not going to download obviously the model into our workspace. It's just the simil. We lock into the registry a wrapper of the how to say the connection, the client, which is connecting with the OpenAI API, and then on we will take this model itself. It's like taking a transformers or a deep learning model that you have physically in your workspace. It's in this case our model is the client, which is connecting with the API of one of these providers, and with this we create a Python model with the PyFont class, and then on we will use this model first of all to register as a final model into the model registry, and secondly to do inference with an arbitrary class that we will send, an arbitrary code that we will send for review. So important in terms of the logistics is the Database runtime. Try to take the latest one available with machine learning, so you don't need to, this way you will not need to install OpenAI libraries, because the runtime come with OpenAI already, and also MLflow comes with the latest version. So try to get if you had a version, old version, is probably going to be very difficult to run this code, because the version every runtime is designed or verified with a group of the versions all together, and then this you have the warranty from Databricks that is gonna work. If you try to install OpenAI or LangChain or whatever you are gonna use on top of what you had on the runtime, most likely what's gonna happen is you are going to break the runtime, and you will have to simply change to another runtime or rebuild the cluster, because it's most of the cases it's not again a very good idea to replace the versions, especially if the difference in between versions are how to say very big, no? You have the major versions or two or three numbers in terms of the minor is, yeah, because many times this major version or is also being adapted to different Python or other libraries that are working together with the OpenAI or Unchained or whatever you are installing, and believe me, it's only going to be problem. So try to use, as I'm using here, I'm using the 15.3 ML beta. If you had, I tried with the 13.3 ML and it didn't work. So finally, because two problems essentially, one it was the OpenAI version installed in the runtime, the second was the MLflow version installed as well in the runtime. And then on replace, MLflow is definitely not a good idea because it's integrated and tested for that specific runtime and versions of the Scala and the rest of the libraries. And again, not a good idea to replace these libraries. Try to choose a different runtime. So we use, we import the libraries we need. You can see here we import the model signature. This is only available in the last three versions of MLflow. So again, try to, if you had in the version 13.3, this is not available. This schema is quite recently implemented or released by MLflow. So if you had again our version an old runtime, is not gonna work. I put my OpenAI key in a key vault in Azure. I'm working in Microsoft Azure, and then I get a secret scope connected with the key vault, and then I have my key there, and then I get the key using dbutil secrets. If you are not familiar with this, I recommend you to watch some of the videos I have on the channel and explaining how dbutil secrets works and or how to you can work with secrets. There is a specific videos to on this topic in this series of the ML and MLOps with Databricks. So once we get the key, we just put the key on the environment and we simply check it as well. We create a experiment. If you are working inside Databricks, don't forget that it had to be that format, slash users, slash your username and the name of the experiment. So let's do here two, just to create it a new one. Yeah, we have now, if we go to experiments, probably we have now, this is code helper two, and there is nothing there. This way you can see. Okay, we create an instruction, typical instruction, zero soft prompting with OpenAI. We just provide some instruction to the LLM. It's a code review, and then this is what he had to do, and we pass the code in this variable. Now with the new versions, you can define the signature very easily. You just define with the it's kind of, you are familiar with Pydantic, is something really similar. You just define the type of the input. There is some data types that you probably well review the documentation, but now it's much more easier. Before, you need to how to say to make an inference with your model. Many cases you need to specify separately the type of especially if you are working with the leads, the type of the or arrays. Yeah, it's much more complicated. Right now, they simplified how to infer the signature of the model. That in this case, especially for this kind of LLMs, is slightly complicated. Parameters. You have an input, an output, and parameters. The parameters that you specify here is the ones that you will be allowed to use later on. And then what happens if you don't introduce here, for example, Toggle, you will not be able to use it. So, sorry. If you plan to use Toggle, introduce it here, get a value by default, and later on you decide to send this as a parameter or not. Here we just specify that we will use max tokens and temperature, and the default values are those ones. Now what we do here is lock the model with the flavor OpenAI and model type GPT-4. The tags is OpenAI chat completions. This as well. Check the why I insist on this topic of the runtime, because OpenAI that should probably not change the API probably back to January, February this year, and then also not the Prestable, or the models are not available. And depending which version of the library that you have, it's not gonna work with the new API. So again, this with this runtime is working. If you have another one, I'm not guarantee you that it's gonna work. Messages and signature, and then we lock the model. Okay, so now we can go here. Yes, login the model. And here check we use the flavor OpenAI. You are following the channel. We have several examples of working with MFlow. Every library that integrate with MFlow natively had a flavor into MFlow. OpenAI, PyTorch, TensorFlow, Scikit-learn, SciFi, pardon, SPICy, Prophet, whatever, LangChain, Transformers, everything had that is integrated, like you see here. Natively is you can go to deep learning. You have all these flavors. You can go to traditional ML, and you had everything here: Spark, XGBoost, Prophet, stat models like GBN. Everything that integrate directly, you will have a flavor here. And then what means that also Cohere or Azure Machine Learning Studio, Transformers, Anthropic models. What means that well, this is a class specifically designed for that library. And a part of that, there is the generic class, which is a PyFunc, and this with this class you can work with any library. That this is what we're gonna do right now. For logging the base model, we use the specific class as we did here, and you can see here. First of all, here the model you see here is an OpenAI model, and you can go here to artifacts. You have the metadata, the model YAML is a GPT-4, tag chat completions, the content, the user, blah blah blah, distraction. So here you have the model card is OpenAI, the signature, and everything that you need to run the model here in this environment. And then on here also, you want to move this model to another environment. You probably see here everything that you need. OpenAI 1.21, 29, 0 MFlow, Tick Token, etc. Python 3.11, very important. Yeah, Python environment. This is working with virtual environment, Conda, and the requirements txt. So once we have the OpenAI model installed, so here in the model info we have the URI of this model. Yeah, you see here model info URI. So this is pointing to is the run 21D8. If you go here, is this model. Okay, I'm pointing to base model. Okay, so now we create our code helper class. We are going to use a class, not a function. Yes, as usual, when you have some complex logic, it's necessary to do it with a class. The class minimally need to have a definition of your predict. I will cover this now. And how it works. When you register the model in the model registry, what it's doing essentially is creating an object with some metadata which is pointing to the relevant artifacts that you need. What we are doing here, we are using the method loadContext that to load the original model that we load here. As you remember, here we are just saving in the model registry, in the tracking server, in the artifact repository of MLflow. We are saving the client which is connecting to our to the API of OpenAI, and we will use GPT-4 and we will do these tags. So when you load the model, when you serialize the model, you are just serializing again all the metadata and artifacts that you need to do inference, no? In with your model. In this case, as you can see here, we just in the experiment we are just serializing how to connect to the API. This is our model, no? And then now we create a function with essentially a class is going to redefine the method predict, and when you instantiate this function, and this happens when you are loading the model, when you make a call to load model, what happened at that point is you create an instance of code helper. If you have something on the init, it will be run, and then immediately when you do a load model, it's executing what you have here. And what you have here, you are loading another model with the PY form and pointing to some path. We will cover this later on. Then you need to redefine your method predict. And what we are doing in predict, we are taking the model, we are taking the model input, and we pass the parameters. And we return this with this. Well, this is just a helper to format nicely the output of the of our GPT-4 of our model. Here, essentially, we are sending. We are just essentially doing a prediction. You can see here inside the predict there is another predict. Why? Because also OpenAI is a PY font. Or PYFO model, it had defined as well the method predict. All the models that are working with MLflow had the method predict which encapsulate the real inference of that model. Okay, we had our class, just keep in memory this and this. Now, what we are doing, we are logging into MLflow, into the model, into the tracking server, the Python model, this one, the code helper. And then the artifact is going to be that one inside the experiment. We pass the Python model, we make an instance, we pass an arbitrary input, the signature and artifacts. What are artifacts? Artifacts is a dictionary which contains everything that you need to make this class works and to inference. What essentially need, you can see here. You pass as model path, look here, model path, the URI of the previously saved or log GPT model, GPT-4 model that we log in the previous experiment. Take a look. That one is model info. We log the model here. It's in that run, which is this one. And we take this model and we pass here as parameter. So what's going to happen here? When we load this model, when we retrieve this model from the model registry, we will create an instance of Code Helper. We will execute the init, and the second one, it will be executed in the load context. And in the load context, what we are doing, we are loading essentially the client, the GPT-4 client, which is encapsulated in a second PY font on a second MLflow model. And then on, now we had this model, the second model as well. Let's run it because we didn't run. There's datetime, and now we are going to log the second model, or the wrapper in this case. And it's gonna take some seconds. Okay, it's done. Now we go to our experiment, and you can see here we have two models, the base model and the wrapper in Python model. You can go here, you go to artifacts, and then you have here in artifacts the base model with its our GPT-4 and the model here is a PyFund model. If you check here, is OpenAI. So now we had in this path here, we have the final model that we will use for inference. And the model, as you know, is containing a client to connect to OpenAI API and chat with GPT-4. So here, the helper model is contained in another path. Check it out, it's ED3A. Here we go here, ED3A. And now, what we are gonna do is just load the model from the model registry with PyFoam load model. So what is doing this essentially? As you remember, we are loading the model, pointing to this URL, and then what we are doing is we create an instance of this class, we cover the init, and then on we call the load context. And the load context itself is loading the model that we pass here in this artifact, which is the original model, the original GPT-4 model loaded here or locked here. So now we have here what is our ladder helper. You can check here is a Python model. And here we'll just say the last run, and then now we are going to log the model into the model registry. So this is the URL, and then we will log the model with MLflow register model. We take the helper model and we register the model there. So we have different one, this is the version 4. So let's check. Now it's gonna take some seconds. Okay, version 4. Models. You can check here. I had the version 3 production. This is the model I used on the previous video. And our model is not in a state known. You may remember that we had 4 stages known. The model is not active. Staging and production. Staging is kind of development. Production is you can use it for inference. And archive, which is you cannot use it anymore. It's not active. So models which are in archive, they are gone. And this is the model governance that you can implement with MLflow. It's quite simple to understand. It's active models that you can, well, you can always retrieve the model from the experiment, but well, usually what we do in MLOps is use the model registry and move the model from stage to stage when we want to use it from productions. And when the model is obsolete or is not performing correctly, we just replace it with another model and we archive it. And then, now we are going to test our model. We are going to check with shared register model. We have version 3, version 4, version 2. Version 1 is already archived. By default, it's only giving 3. If I don't remember wrong, exactly. Originally, you just receive 3, return, blah, blah, blah. I don't remember, Ron, is you can specify the number of objects that you want to receive. And now what we are going to do is to archive the version 3. We take the model, check here, is code helper, is a PyPhone model, and we archive it. What happened here, this model is already archived. Now we take the version 4 from our model registry. You can check here is as well a code from code helper, MLflow PyPhone, and the ED3A. If you check here is that one, which is our code helper model. Okay, PyPhone. And you can see here version 4 is registered on the model. Also you can check here in the artifacts. So this is the wrapper with the class code helper, and inside the class we have the artifacts, which is the base model, which is the client to OpenAI to interact with the GPT-4. Now we just simply copy this model into another object, and now we create a helper function where we pass a function to review it and the model. What we're going to do here with inspect, inspect is a class from Python, we take the code of the function that you pass here, and then we send it we execute essentially predict from the model. Predict is what you have here, and then check here in the class, predict. When we call predict, what we are doing, we are taking the model we have here. Remember that this is the client, the OpenAI client, pointing to the GPT-4, and then we are taking the model and invoking the predict model. Why we invoke the predict model? Because it's another PyPhone, it's another MLflow model, and all models in MLflow have the same methods to do inference. Everything is encapsulated in a kind of generic class, and all the models behave identically, similar. So they have the same methods, load context and predict. This is a standard, and then any model, and then doing that, what it's doing essentially is sending to the OpenAI model, we are sending to where? To the chat completions, the instruction that we will send as a message to the model. So model input, what is going to be the model input, what we specified as model input in our inference. So when we do a predict, we just send the context. The context is given automatically. The model input is going to be the function and parameters. If you specified okay, it's not is taking the parameters from the context, which are the parameters that you define in your signature here. Yeah. You could send here. Let's check. We can set params. Let me, you can set up here. And then here we just send predict with the source code. The source code is the output of inspecting the function that we will receive here in this parameter. Okay, here we take a function. You can use whatever. And then on we just send this function to the staging model, which is the one that we download our version 4. We just execute it and you have the output. It's taking some seconds. Okay. And you have the 4 points that we sent on the and the optimized version of your code, and you have a code reviewer. For those are lazy like me, you have here a very nice function. Everything now you can integrate this in a bigger pipeline, and everything is inside the database, meaning that you get access to a bunch of technologies that are integrated with your workspace. You can work with big data, you can work with everything. You have access directly to the MLflow facilities that are integrated in the Databricks UI, and well, whatever you is possible to be used with the Databricks, you have access to. The last stage, we just move the model to production. We can do it before the running the inference, but I did it at the end, and now you have it here, production, the version 4. And well, that's all. Pretty interesting stuff. I want to do something more. Probably if I find I need to check the documentation. Now we are working essentially with models that only accept text. I want to check if it is possible to do with a multimodal model like the Claude 3 or GPT-4o or Gemini. Well, Gemini probably is not possible, but yeah, it's not included here. Probably it's not still not possible to be used, but well, I will try with Anthropic or with GPT-4o. It is possible. I will make a third video of the LLM Ops just to complete the series of this topic, which is really interesting, and you see how easy is to create a pipeline to lock your any model again, because it is not here included, and the only thing sorry, where is that? It is not here included in your in the list of the technologies that they are automatically or natively integrated. You can create always a custom model, which is a Python model, and you can create the logic to do the inference. At the end, if you type only to create a personal or custom predict, and you load in the method to define a class like we did here, and then you need to define this, and in the load context, load whatever you need to your model works. And then on in this case, if your model input is we can try to wrap this with a multimodal model and just creating a custom model with a Python model. And then see in the model we just simply load the, for example in this case, Gemini using the right libraries, and we simply pass to the predict, for example, images or whatever is needed. I will try to do it myself. If I get it, I will prepare a third video for doing all this stuff with a multimodal model, which is probably one of the most interesting things that we had today on this industry. And well, that's all. I will upload this now to the repo. You can later on play with that in your local environment. And I hope you like it. And it was useful for you and for your work, for your training, for whatever you are watching this video. I hope that it was useful and again you like it. And if it was like this, give me a like, subscribe to the channel if you didn't do it before, and share with others to help me to promote the channel. Also, you can write messages, whatever, in the channel. I will answer as soon as I have time. Thank you very much. Bye bye.